Okay, if I could encourage those leaving the public gallery to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible as we move on to the next item of business, which is a members' business debate on motion 13031 in the name of Martin Whitfield on foster care fortnight. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons, and I invite Martin Whitfield to open the debate around 7 minutes. Mr. Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it is right that I start by thanking those members who supported this motion to allow the debate this afternoon in the Chamber. And I'd also like to thank those members who are going to participate in the debate this afternoon, and indeed those in the audience who wish to stay. But this is an important debate, because when we talk about fostering and foster families, what do we mean? Well, in a situation where a child cannot be cared for by their birth parent or by kinship carers, that extended family or close friends, they can be cared for by an approved foster family. And the important two words in there is family and approved. It's the coming together of an agreement that a family can care for a child from out with their family. This is an important debate because we take this time to mark Foster Care Fortnight here in the Parliament, because foster care is so important for our young people. And I would like at this outset to thank the Fostering Network for their help with regard to this. The fortnight runs from the 13th to the 26th of May, and this year's Foster Care Fortnight looks at celebrating fostering moments, all of those big, small moments that define fostering for carers, for children and families. And it also allows me to give a plug for the Minister, who on Sunday the 19th of May will be joining fostering families in a short walk in Mugdock Park in Milngavie, because it is all the small moments, the sometimes less important moments as observed by those on the outside, that make all of the difference to the young people and the children, and indeed the families. So can, in anticipation, wish the Minister well with that. Foster care and foster carers are vital for the nurture and development of our children and young people. Foster care provides a loving home, care, support for some of the most vulnerable children in our society. And it's because of how important foster care is in the wider system of support for children and young people, it is so critical that we get it right. And part of it, getting it right, is ensuring that we have enough foster carers. And another is supporting and equipping the ones that we do have. There are currently 3,261 fostering households caring for 3,927 children here in Scotland. And I'm sure the whole chamber will join me in simply saying thank you to each and every one of them for all of the hard work that they do. But it is a sad reality that that number is just under 5% less than it was last year. And that means that we need to do more. The Fostering Network, alongside many agencies and local authorities, have voiced concerns that the number of fostering households in Scotland is decreasing. We are approximately 400 families short here in Scotland. And I hope that today's debate, we can look at recruitment, retention, an issue that faces many of our vital services as local authorities are stretched thin and our public services have less and less capacity. But there is reward in fostering, and that's partly what this fortnight celebrates. Those moments when a giggle, a laugh, an ice cream, an arm around someone at the right time, a silly story at bedtime, can both help the young person but also help the family that offer it. And part of retention goes in hand with ensuring we get it right for our young people. And that is about the support, that is about equipping, and that is about valuing our foster carers. Some of the things that the network have highlighted that would improve retention are, of course, improved training, increasing the status of foster carers, improving the pay that they receive.
Ms. McCall.
I thank I thank Mr Whitfield for taking the intervention. And talking about steps to improve, step up, step down is a process that the Fostering Network are doing, and it's something I've got in my speech. I was wondering if he would support that form of inventiveness in Scotland.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful for that intervention, and indeed so many interventions that support our foster families are crucially important. I think of Place to Be, who I have the privilege of sponsoring for an exhibition this week just outside this chamber, and the work that they've done directly with foster families rather than the young people to equip those families with the tools, the strategies, sometimes the patience that's needed in difficult situations. So I'm very grateful for that intervention. I'm sure other members will take the opportunity, as indeed the intervention just has, to look at a way at how we improve going forward with the solutions, with the good practice, and how we can better do this across the board so that there is less of a postcode lottery. In my own region, the south of Scotland, I know that East Lothian Council have highlighted in several reports over the last few years the issues that they have with recruitment of foster carers. And a quote from one of the reports says, "At this time, we do not have sufficient East Lothian Council foster carers to meet the demand of children who require foster placements." And I know that a significant amount of work and resources has been and will continue to be invested in this by East Lothian Council. But for the best outcomes for our children and young people, we need to support and fund our local authorities and those third sector that provide similar services, because they are struggling to meet demand. Supporting our foster carers and the children they foster is part of the wider picture of making sure that the promise is more than just a headline. It is a key piece of the jigsaw that will ensure care-experienced children and young people grow up safe, grow up loved, grow up respected. And if we are serious about the delivery, not just the headlines, we do need to fund our local authorities to do all of these things so that our hard-working foster carers can be supported well, and so that in turn children and young people receive the care and support that they need. As I close, I want to once again thank all of Scotland's brilliant, wonderful, marvellous foster carers, and by thanking the Fostering Network for all the hard work that they do, supporting our foster carers and representing their voices. And in the spirit of the theme of this fortnight, which is Fostering Moment, let this debate be the moment that foster carers and those in foster care know the importance we place in this Parliament on them. And let's make the next moment the way that this Parliament can help deliver the support they need. I'm grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr Whitfield. We now move to the open debate. I call first Rona Mackay to be followed by Ros McCall, around 4 minutes. Ms. Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be able to speak in this important debate during Foster Care Fortnight, and I thank Martin Whitfield for bringing it to the Chamber, even if he did pronounce Mogai incorrectly. I'm sure my colleague, Mary McNair, picked that up. I also acknowledge his dedication to the subject of care-experienced young people. Presiding Officer, nothing's more important than giving a child the best start in life and a loving, stable home. As the motion says, that there are currently 3,927 children and young people living in foster care in Scotland, but there are 400 more fostering households needed, with that number decreasing by 4.8% since 2021. Presiding Officer, we are in the middle of a cost of living crisis, and people may understandably be nervous of further commitment. All foster carers receive a weekly fostering allowance when they have a child in foster care living with them, designed to cover the cost of looking after a child, which varies with their age and includes food, clothes, toiletries, travel and other expenses incurred. There are issues around rates and possible postcode lottery, and I hope the Minister will address that in closing. But fostering is about more than finances. This is about setting a young person on the right course and giving them the precious gift of a family life. There's a particular need for foster carers who can look after sibling groups. In 2022, 70% of services reported difficulties recruiting families who could take siblings, and 24% of family groups in foster care were placed separately. Keeping siblings together is a key tenet of the promise, and I'm quite dismayed to hear those figures. But make no mistake, fostering can be demanding, stressful at times, and requires endless patience and problem solving. But the emotional rewards far outweigh any of those things. To make a difference to a child's life must surely be worth every sleepless night and extra grey hair. The theme of the 2024 Fortnight is fostering moments, as Martin Whitfield described, and those moments in a young person's life will last a lifetime. Presiding Officer, I'm proud of the Scottish Government's continuing commitment to fulfil the promise, ensuring that care-experienced children get the support and protection they deserve. A key foundation of the promise is that where children are safe in their families and feel loved, they should stay. In 2023 in Scotland, 51% of children leaving care returned home to their parents, suggesting that more could possibly have been done to prevent these children from being taken into care in the first place. The Scottish Government's Whole Family Wellbeing Fund is aimed at significantly reducing the number of children and young people who are living away from their families by 2030. And our recently passed Children Care and Justice Bill, brought forward by the Minister, builds on that commitment and is another step to fulfilling our promise to them. The Fostering Network, Adoption UK, Place to Be and other third sector organisations such as Children First provide a huge amount of caring for our children who need a home. I recently led a members' debate and held a reception to highlight the great work the Fostering Network does. And its Fostering Friendly Employer Scheme focuses on how employers can support employees going through the fostering process. It's aimed to ensure foster carers have the opportunity for paid leave, for training, respite, meetings and other requirements to fulfil their vital role. And I hope this theme will help boost awareness of the need for more foster carers and make employers think how they could help employees fulfil their wish. The scheme was set up in 2014 in response to the findings that foster carers do need more flexibility and understanding from their employers in order to work alongside fostering. And there are now 120 fostering friendly employers in the UK, and I'm proud to say that I'm one of them. Presiding Officer, I've spoken before of the experience I have of being a fostering friendly employer. My head of office has two adorable adopted siblings and went through a thorough and detailed process beginning with fostering. And now when I see his happy, thriving children, I know that every absence from the office was worth it. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I urge anyone considering fostering to reach out and make it happen. Hundreds of children need you right now. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. I now call Rose McCall to be followed by the member for Milngavie. Ms McCall, around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Rona Mackay, I'm only going to mention my grey hair started after I adopted two daughters. But anyway, I'm delighted to speak today, and I thank Martin Whitfield for bringing forward this member's business to celebrate the Fostering Network, foster carers in general, and this year's Foster Carers Fortnight. I also want to echo his comments that I know how much of a supporter the Minister is. We met last year at Blair Drummond at the Fostering Fortnight, and I will be also there walking in Milngavie in Mugduck Country Park on Sunday. So I know the effort that the Minister puts in. This year the theme is Fostering Moments, and as is customary, it's time for me to overshare, because the memories I have of those early years when we were a fostering family and not a forever family are included in the moments that I will cherish all my life. It's the small things, the infinitesimal changes that don't immediately jump out at you but slowly creep up upon you, showing that trust is growing, security and comfort are steeping in, and that barriers of safety that were built up over the times of uncertainty are not impregnable as they once were. That time when their young face searched the crowd at the school nativity and broke into a smile at seeing me when at previous plays it didn't matter. The time when they proudly showed me drawings and schoolwork and progress charts, waiting with genuine eagerness for positive reactions, when until then the outward demeanour was nonchalant, casual and distant. And the time they accepted my word in trust that I would be at the park, I wouldn't go away, that I would go to the shops, and that dinner would be on time, without questioning, without anxiety and without judging. These are but moments, minuscule moments in a person's perception, but monumental changes nonetheless for a child who had quite simply been let down by adults time and time again. We can never underestimate the role that foster carers play in building the confidences and attachments within our young people. It's imperative that we ensure this value support continues, but unfortunately, as already mentioned, foster carer numbers are declining. I also thank the Fostering Network for their briefing for today. There's so much in it that needs addressing, but I've selected a couple of points. They state that while the number of children in care, including foster carers, continues to decline in Scotland, the number of fostering households is falling at a faster rate, and that the Care Inspectorate has reported a downward trend in new foster carer approvals over the past 5 years, which has accelerated in the last year. This is concerning, especially when you add that to the recent report from Who Cares Scotland, who rightly raised the point that when it comes to the reduction of children in care, it's unclear whether this is indicative of progress towards the goal of keeping more children at home with their families, or due to a lack of social work intervention, meaning children are being left in unsafe homes. And I urge the Scottish Government to assure all data collection on this issue is robust in this aspect. I'm sure the Minister is aware, but I would like to draw attention to the Fostering Network's fantastic Step Up, Step Down initiative. I've already mentioned it in a very badly worded intervention, which supports families on the edge of the care system, and it's currently utilised in Northern Ireland and in Wales. This process has demonstrated reduced numbers of children coming into care and improved outcomes for children and families, which not only supports the intention of the promise, but ensures no child is missed. And I would appreciate any chance the Minister has to discuss this with her directly. So in conclusion, our foster families go above and beyond for children in their care. Many are taking children beyond the age range that they are approved to take. Many are looking after more children that they are approved to have. Thank you seems too small a word for the work they do, but nonetheless, thank you.
Thank you, Ms McCall. And I call Marie McNair, around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My thanks to Martin Whitfield for bringing this debate to the Chamber. And can I bring members' attention to my register of interest, having been a councillor in Western Bartonshire from 2003 until 2022. I speak in this debate as a former councillor who sat on the council's adoption and foster panel for over 15 years. This was a real privilege and gave me a greater insight into the importance of good foster care. It can have such a profound impact upon the lives of children and young people, giving them the chance to live in a loving and stable environment. This annual campaign helps us shed a positive light on foster care and lets us celebrate the hard work, dedication and commitment of foster carers. As previously said, in Scotland there are approximately 3,261 approved fostering families in Scotland and 3,927 children living with foster families as of July 2023. The theme this year, Fostering Moments, lets us celebrate the big and small moments that celebrate and create memories and help transform young people's lives, the moments that define fostering journeys. And it's very often that these are small moments in foster care that have the biggest impact. I was touched reading about some of the moments foster carers told the Adolescents and Children's Trust. One that really hit me was this. The boys learning to ride bikes will be a memory that stays with me forever. I will never forget their whoops of joy as they shouted, I can ride a bike. And Andrew, a young person who was placed in foster care in Eastern Bartonshire, said, every day is always good with my foster parents, but the thing that I have always loved is on a Sunday, whether it's warm or rainy. Loads of family come up and my foster mum makes a massive steak pie and everyone is there and we all just eat together and watch TV. It's not much, but it means a lot to me. I'm grateful for the life they have given me, and this has been the best life I have ever hoped for. It's so clear these small moments that some of us may take for granted have the biggest impact and help to transform the lives of young people in care. Whatever the fostering moment is, it's about making a connection with that young person and it's about making them feel cared for. No matter how small the moment, they have a huge impact. In my constituency, there are so many excellent foster carers, and for them, I am so grateful. And both the West and Eastern Bartonshire Health and Social Care Partnerships do amazing work providing support groups, training and dedicated support workers for foster parents in the area. Supporting foster parents is so essential, and I know many would struggle without the support of their supervising social worker. When foster parents are well supported, they're able to offer the best care for their children and young people. And while we recognise the amazing work and commitment of current foster carers, this fortnight also serves as a chance to try and encourage others to take up foster care. It is not, of course, something that you can ever rush into. It is challenging, but it is really rewarding. But there are so many caring individuals out there who could change the lives of children in care. So if people think this might be them, please consider it. They're always looking for more foster carers. Every child deserves to grow up safe and loved. And good foster care can change a child's life. It can turn it around and put them on a path to a brighter future. So I celebrate the work of our local foster carers and thank them for everything they do. I cannot thank them enough. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNair. And I now call on Natalie Dawn to respond to the debate. Minister, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'd firstly like to thank Martin Whitfield for initiating today's debate and thank members for all of their contributions, notably some very personal contributions, so thank you. This debate, I think, has enabled us as a Parliament to recognise the Fostering Network's annual Foster Care Fortnight. And as members have said, it's an excellent opportunity to celebrate foster carers and acknowledge the vital difference that they make to the lives of children and young people. Earlier this week, I published a letter to all foster carers thanking them for all that they do. But I'd also like to put on record here today my sincere thanks to all foster carers and practitioners working in the sector. We absolutely recognise the key role they play in providing nurturing homes and wider support for children and young people across Scotland. What they do positively transform lives, and the family-based care foster carers provide is key to our collective commitment to keep the promise. I'd also like to take this opportunity to add my thanks to the Fostering Network in Scotland for all the work that they do in organising Foster Care Fortnight. It has been so heartening this year, I think, to see this year's theme of fostering moments shared on social media. And I was really delighted to take part myself by sharing a short video highlighting some of my favourite moments. But I'd like to speak to that a little bit in today's debate. Some of these include meeting with foster carers, as has already been mentioned, at Blair Drummond Safari Park for last year's Foster Care Fortnight. I've met with the Fostering Network's Young People Advisory Board, a really inspiring group of young people, and finally hosting a small event in Parliament for some incredible foster carers, young people with care experience, sons, daughters, social workers, and others in the fostering community who had won a Fostering Excellence Award. It really is memories like these that hold a special place in my heart and really motivate me to continue working hard, not only to improve fostering, but to keep the promise as well. Now, Mr Whitfield is right that I will be walking for Foster Care Fortnight, and I'm really looking forward to this day being a huge success. Now, as Martin Whitfield highlighted in the motion for today's debate, and many others have raised, there are challenges, including the retention and recruitment of foster carers. But there are also opportunities for everyone, national and local government, the third sector and local communities in supporting our foster carers. As we've said, foster care is absolutely key to delivering fully on the promise, and it's vital that the Scottish Government leads from the front if we are to ensure that all care experienced children and young people are supported to grow up loved, safe and respected. Now, we set out our commitment to do that in the Promise Implementation Plan, which was published in 2022 and will be updated in the coming weeks. And I think this is a really important year for the promise, a year that is reflected, but where we are looking forward at the steps that we still need to take to fulfil our commitment, and fostering is an important part of that. Our vision is to ensure that every child lives in a safe and loving home and where families are given support to overcome difficulties and stay together. And work has begun on delivering this vision aligned with the government's... Yes, I will.
Ros McCall.
Sorry, again on that point, the promise hoping to try and keep families together and the points that you're making, would you be willing to meet with me regarding step up, step down? As I know, it is out in Ireland and in Wales, and it's something that maybe we could have a look at in Scotland.
Always through the chair. Minister.
Absolutely. What I was going to come on to step up, step down. just to let you know, I'm really interested in the outcomes around this programme. So my officials have already met with the fostering network in Northern Ireland who run Step Up, Step Down, and will continue to liaise with Northern Ireland and the Welsh Government, who are piloting as well, to measure those outcomes. But I'm happy to discuss that more with the member. Now, as I say, work has begun on delivering this vision aligned with the mission to eradicate child poverty, to redesign the children's hearing system and to look at the future of children's services. We've provided funding to the third sector to support foster carers, which includes £150,000 to the Fostering Network Scotland this year to support the Foster Line Scotland service. The Scottish Government has also been working with a small group of partners, including the Fostering Network, the Promise Scotland, local authorities and others, to look at how we attract and retain foster carers and what action we can take collectively. The group has developed proposals which include a package of emotional, practical and financial supports for foster carers so they feel better valued and supported. And these proposals will form part of a public consultation on the future of fostering, which we will launch in autumn this year. Our fostering consultation, which is part of a wider coordinated package of consultations, will propose a new vision for foster care in Scotland in the 21st century, with early intervention, prevention and family reunification at its heart. This consultation will also outline work on recruitment and retention, which is already underway, as well as some new proposals, and will ask about practice-based issues which we have heard impact on foster carers day-to-day. We also plan to undertake extensive engagement with children and young people with experience of foster care, foster carers, practitioners and all those working within the fostering community. Voice was at the heart of the independent care review, and I have said before and will say again, it is absolutely essential that those voices continue to be heard and to inform our work to keep the promise. Now, on the financial side, as Ms Mackay has noted, there is more work to do. However, last August I was able to introduce the Scottish Recommended Allowance for Foster and Kinship Carers, which was a huge milestone. And this is making a big difference to the daily lives of more than 9,000 children and young people in foster and kinship care in Scotland. However, I know there is more to do, and this will be explored in the consultation I mentioned earlier. I'm also carefully considering, given the financial challenges facing the whole of the public sector at the moment, on upgrading the allowances in this financial year, and I plan to make an announcement shortly following discussion with COSLA. On the practical side, we've also started work to scope out how we can best support foster carers through training to deal with the impact of trauma on the children and the young people that foster carers care for. Last year, during a members' debate led by Rona Mackay, I committed that the Scottish Government would look at opportunities to become a more supportive and flexible employer to employees who are also foster carers. And I'm delighted to say that we are working towards having the Scottish Government's human resources special leave policy updated by autumn 24, so that all employees who are foster and kinship carers will have access to dedicated foster and kinship leave to support their roles as carers. My hope is that by leading from the front, the Scottish Government can work with and persuade other public and private sector employers across Scotland to do the same and support their foster and kinship carers. So I'd like to conclude by saying that whilst today's debate is an important opportunity to reflect on our collective work to keep the promise by 2030, I want to again thank Scotland's foster carers for their commitment. There is absolutely no doubt that they improve the lives of children and young people in their care and make our collective vision for them a reality. Thank you all.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I suspend this meeting of Parliament until 2 o'clock.